Once again, greetings to one and all in the most holy and matchless name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. For today's meditation, that is September 27, 2021, the selected scripture portion is Galatians chapter 3. I'd like to request one and all to pause this video and read individually Galatians chapter 3. Galatians chapter 3 is such a vast subject and topic that could usefully occupy many talks of these sessions. But over here for this daily devotions, I shall restrict myself to two major observations. First, in the first 5 verses, Paul appeals to experience. He asks whether the Galatians, whether their conversion and all the experience of the grace of God and the power of Spirit came through as a function of their observance of the law of Moses or as a function of their faith. After all, Christ had been placarded before their eyes as the crucified Savior in Galatians chapter 3 verse 1. They believed what they had heard, Galatians chapter 3 verse 2, and they received the Spirit. This stance had cost them. They had suffered persecution, we read it in verse 4. Moreover, they had witnessed miraculous transforming works of the Spirit, all in function of their God-given faith, Galatians chapter 3 verse 5. Why then should they think that having begun with the Spirit, having begun with the faith, they should now try to attain their goal, presumably for the steps of maturation and knowledge of God by carefully observing the law? That approach, Paul implies, is in contradiction to their conversion. A slur on the suffering they have endured, and in antithesis to their own experience of power of the Spirit of God. What this means is that the path to Christian's goal is faith and the life and the power of the Spirit, not observance of multiplied law. To think otherwise is to be foolish. To listen to those who have bewitched us with false notions of spirituality that tear us away from the crucified Christ. The second major argument is that the argument in the rest of the chapter focuses not on individual Christians' experiences, but on the history of God's redemptive purpose. In other words, Paul is not saying that the law of God must operate in each unbeliever's conscience if that person is to come to Christ. No, that may or may not be true, but it is not what Paul is addressing. Rather, Paul seeks to establish the priority of faith for our justification as far back in history as Abraham, chapter 3 verses 6 to 9. That immediately raises the question as to why the law of Moses was added at all. Paul does not here offer a complete analysis of the various purposes served by the law, but emphasizes certain points. It was not added to overturn the principles already established at the time of Abraham, nor to offer an alternative path to salvation. No, rather, law made human sin clear and undeniable as it exposed it as transgression. Thus, it drove people across the redemptive historical timeline to Jesus Christ. One of the ways in which Paul's understanding of the Old Testament differs from that of his colleagues is that he insists on reading it along its temporal axis. Paul is explaining how the Bible fits together. May God bless you all.